and compassionate choices to their residents. It's appropriate that we've gathered here in this sanctuary. This is where the Oregon Death with Dignity Act was conceived, in this very room. Most of the people who helped write it and who fought for it worshiped in these pews. I was saying, I think it's the very same upholstery on the very same cushions that were here 20 years ago. This was the Death with Dignity Act's church home. On November 8, 1994, voters passed that law by a close margin, 51% to 49%, and this congregation rejoiced. That month, Brittany Maynard turned 10. Over the next 20 years, Brittany grew up, and so did Oregon's Death with Dignity Act. The National Right to Life Committee went to court, and they got the law stalled for 3 years. Brittany completed elementary school. The Oregon legislature forced a second statewide vote that was soundly defeated the very month Brittany became a teenager. People started using their new law. People started using their new law. A congressional bill to trump Oregon with federal power met a narrow defeat in Congress. Brittany finished her education and she started a life of adventure. A new administration came into power and they named John Ashcroft as Attorney General. And Attorney General Ashcroft threatened Oregon doctors with federal drug laws. Brittany traveled to Africa and Tanzania and Zanzibar. She climbed Mount Kilimanjaro. Oregon challenged Ashcroft in a case that went all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. Brittany traveled to Southeast Asia and worked in orphanages there. Another federal bill to override Oregon's law failed. And in 2006, finally, the very last legal challenge to the Oregon law fell. Brittany was 22. In January, those two histories converged when Brittany learned she had terminal brain cancer. She and her family faced this harsh reality together, and the rest is history. Just at the last few days of October, YouGov.com polled Americans and found that nearly 40% of Americans have heard of Brittany Maynard and know that she supports Oregon's Death with Dignity law. That's about 100 million Americans. From this congregation, from these pews, to 100 million Americans. Brittany's call to action was simple. Share love. Cherish every precious moment of your life. And help those who are dying get a chance for peace and dignity on their own terms. Change the law and medical practice in every state. Now, those specific calls to action will vary state by state, but in Oregon, they are these. Number one, visit thebrittanyfund.org and find instructions there for action. And number two, in Oregon in particular, it's important for everyone to talk to their own physician about our end-of-life options and whether or not a physician would participate in the Oregon Death with Dignity Law. We need to become a constituency of consumers that expects what Brittany expected and what she received. Honesty and options from our physicians. Shortly before her death, and I mean shortly before her death, Brittany sat on her bed and she wrote these words. I won't live to see the Death with Dignity movement reach critical mass, but I call on you to carry it forward. I have to believe that the pain we've endured has a greater purpose in the change we can create as a nation. I leave it in your hands. And so it is now, in our hands. I want to introduce Reverend Bill Sinkford, the senior minister of this church.
Barbara. It is my privilege to serve this church with its long history of support for death with dignity. Here in First Unitarian, the inherent worth and dignity of every individual does not end as we near death. Dignity and compassion remain important until the end. And it is our religious point of view that they should for all people. That is our religious point of view. Our religious point of view is that Brittany's decision and the way she and her family carried that decision out were blessings. They were blessings. And so this evening we gather, blessed by Brittany's life and by the way she witnessed with her death. We saw her careful decision-making, and we saw her willingness to be both so personal and so public as she died. It takes a remarkable individual, I think, to live at the intersection of the personal and the political, and she did it so well. She was compassionate to herself and to those she loved, but she was willing to have her voice be heard. In my religious life and in the religious life of this church, Brittany's choice modeled care and compassion and the movement of love. Her willingness to be so open is blessing us now. We saw her claim control of how she would die, and because of who she was, and because of how she spoke, this has become a Kairos moment, a pivot point, when hearts and minds have somehow been opened. When hearts and minds are somehow open to change and to new ways to love ourselves and one another. In a moment, we're going to light candles. This would have been Brittany's 30th birthday, and that is somehow so appropriate. But candles are also how humans have memorialized important dates and times. It's how humans have memorialized important dates and times since there have been humans. This moment when minds and hearts can change is a lasting gift from Brittany to all of us. It is her final blessing for us. May we find ways in our turn to offer blessing as well and commit ourselves to building a world in which there is more compassion and more dignity for us all. I'm going to come down and light the candles, light your candles, and then we're going to have Matt lead us in song.
I just wanted to remind people the way to light a candle from another candle is to hold the lit candle upright and take the unlit candle and put it in the flame. That way, you don't tip the lit candle and drip melted wax all over the pews.
We shall overcome.
find Brittany and her family. And may that peace find us as well. Not a peace that leads to quietude, but a peace that leads to commitment. Go in peace, go in hope,